You have to have a system to make sure you have data integrity. You can't just say, well, of course we are. Jim wrote it. Jim, we trust Jim. He's been here for 20 years. If he says he wrote it on Wednesday, he wrote it on Wednesday. That is a German attitude, but it's not acceptable. Because in Germany, people work at the same company for years and years and years. And after 20 years of working with somebody, you still don't know his first name. It's Herr Schmidt. So you need to have a system and process designed to encourage compliance with the principles of data integrity. You need to consider ease of access, usability, and location when ensuring proper controls. For example, now this slide is totally stolen by me from the MHRA data integrity guidelines. I make no claim to have written it, so when you get to the guideline, you'll see this exactly again. You need to record times that events happen if you are critical for time. I went to a company in Pittsburgh recently, and every room I went to showed a different time. Not off by 1 minute or 2 minutes. One room said 2:30, another one said 10 minutes past 11. I mean, no synchronization whatsoever. This is Pittsburgh. So you have to have access to clocks, and they should be master-slave synchronized. One master clock and all the others mirror it. And it should, ideally, be synced to a time clock, by these atomic time clocks. I have one in my bedroom. It's every hour on the hour, some signal goes to a satellite, and it's always correct, as is my watch. Accessibility to batch records, and I would also add testing records at locations where the activity takes place, so that ad hoc data recording and later transcription to official records is not necessary. Went to a place recently where the weighing records was written on a paper towel. And then they took the paper towel and took it back to the lab, because the weighing was 3 rooms down. And I said, well, where's the original data? Because I saw them do it on paper towel over there, but here there's no paper towels. And, well, no, we transcribe. Well, the best solution to that is either take the lab book with you or take the paper towel, cut it out, and stick it in the lab book. I mean, one or the other, but I want the original data. Control over blank paper templates for data recording. Many places you go to, they spilled some acid over the paper in the data sheet, go back to the lab, photocopy another data sheet and bring it in. Well, how do we know the original data was the real data and what's been copied now on a new one? FDA doesn't like that at all. Abbott paid a fine of around $250,000 for that about 15 years ago. It was a real big issue. Access rights preventing data amendments. I would expect that the minimum there is an SOP that defines who can access data, who can read data, probably anybody, who can write new data, only authorized validated analysts or trained analysts, who can edit data, probably only one or two people under very strict controls, and who can delete data, even more restrictive controls. But these things need to be defined in SOPs. You need to have audit trails. Audit trails need to be automatically generated. You can't have a little logbook saying, well, I changed this and that, and that's it. The system itself has to have audit trails. And these audit trails need to be reviewed. And FDA's latest thinking is, when you do an HPLC chromatogram, you print out the run sheet, you print out the chromatograms, and then you also print out the audit trail for that day or that operator's work. And it needs to be reviewed as part of the batch record review. Automated data capture and printers attached to the equipment is encouraged. So you don't have to write numbers down, just take a printout. It's encouraged. It's not a must, but it's encouraged. And printers obviously have to be close to where the work is being done. If you're checking data, you also have to have access to the raw data. So when QA does the batch record review and gets the QC lab, it's not sufficient to get just a certificate of analysis from the lab. They need to get the raw data with all the chromatograms, without all the printouts, so that the QA can do a second-person check or a third-person check in some companies. You need to control the physical parameters of time, space, and equipment to perform the tasks to be done as required. Many places don't have room for printers, don't have room for computer input, so they transfer the data by hand, what we call sneakerware. They take a disk or they move it somewhere around. You've got to have enough space to do these things. And as I said before, staff checking the activities need to have the raw data. This is a British thing that allows scribes to record activity on behalf of somebody else under exceptional circumstances. A different company in India, I saw the worker making tablets, and the guy's doing his work, and standing just inside the door of the room is the supervisor with a checklist, the batch record, writing up all the data. Because, can't read, illegibility. Guy's just not able. So the British allow contemporary recording of compromises the productivity to accommodate cultural or staff literacy language and activities performed by an operator but witnessed and recorded by the supervisor. The FDA doesn't allow that. The British do. In both situations, the supervised recording should be contemporaneous, and it goes on. Now, there are different data record formats. It depends on the complexity of what's going on. We can have simple activities all the way through to complex activities. Simple activities may not require software at all, and a printout could represent the original data. For example, I'm doing a weighing. I do the weighing, I get a printout from the printer. There's no computer, no data saved in the weighing balance. There's no linkage to an LIM system. All I do is I weigh it, here's the printout. That's a simple system. All the way to the most complex, which has complex software, and the printout itself doesn't represent the original data. The original data is captured in the hard disk inside the computer. I don't know if you're aware, every time you make a photocopy on your photocopy machine, big one downstairs in the hallway, there's a hard disk in there, and it keeps a copy of what you copied. Police could go in there 10 years from now and see exactly what's been copied on that machine. So that's the original data. The printout is a facsimile. So we have no software all the way through to complex software. And if you put all your pieces of equipment on this scheme, a pH meter has no software, the printout is what you get, that's it. All the way through to enterprise resource planning, LIM systems, even Kappa systems, the further you get, the more complex the data, the more you have to worry about data integrity. Can we trust, can we rely on the data? My slides, by the way, have a series of builds on them. And when you print out the handout, the trouble is it doesn't always print all the series of builds. I'm more than happy if you give me your business card, I can send you the original of the presentation, and then you can see the whole thing, all right? So documentation requirements for data integrity when you do chromatography work. I would expect to see the print run chart, the sample sequence, what you injected, your blanks, your standards, your calculation of system suitability, your actual runs, your system suitability again. So print the system suitability from the start and the end, print all the chromatograms, print all the calculations, and then print the audit trail for all work by that analyst for that day. That's nowadays what is expected to be the minimum for QA to review and for the QC lab manager to review the data. And the FDA is spending a lot of time on the audit trail. There is an inspector, FDA inspector by the name of Peter Baker, who is originally a chemist and is a whiz on this stuff. And I've suffered through two of his inspections, and he knows HPLCs much better than most of you in the lab do. And he can do a number on this. He got so bad that he caused three years ago, 17 Indian pharmaceutical companies to get warning letters. And the result of that was that the Indian Pharmaceutical Association asked the government not to renew his visa. And he got kicked out of India, really, seriously. He spent the next year at FDA headquarters teaching other FDA inspectors exactly what he knew. So now we have Peter Baker and lots of mini Peter Bakers. And Peter Baker then came to China. And I suffered through his second order. I suffered through one in India. I suffered through another one in China. And again, he found things that we had no idea what he was even looking for. And we got another warning letter on that. He's now been kicked out of China as well. I'm not sure where he is now, but he really knows his data integrity. We have to worry about data governance. How do we address who owns the data throughout the life cycle, considering the design, operation, and monitoring of the systems to comply with the principles of data integrity over intentional and unintentional changes of information? How do we control this? Who thinks about it? So include staff training in the importance of data integrity principles, the creation of a work environment that enables the visibility of errors. When you make an error, it should show up. My wife recently had a blood test and her hemoglobin level went down to 6.9. And instead of just reporting the result, overlaid over the result was the word panic, panic, to catch the nurse's attention, the doctor's attention. Because when your hemoglobin goes down to that level, you can die, Nick. Two more drops and you're dead. So they all came running like crazy. You have to have a blood transfusion right now. So that's how you get people's attention. The same with the errors, the visibility of errors. Senior management is responsible to implement the systems and procedures to minimize the potential risk to data integrity and identify the residual risk, the using risk management techniques explained in the risk management ICH guideline. And contract givers, that's you, using an outside lab or an outside testing facility, have to ensure that data ownership, governance, and accessibility are included in a contract and technical agreement. It should also govern data governance as part of your vendor assurance program. So part of your audits now of vendors is, how do they control their data? How do you know that their data has integrity? And raw data has to permit the full reconstruction of the activities resulting in the generation of the data. In the case of basic electronic equipment, which does not store data or provides only a printed output, the printout constitutes the raw material. For HPLCs, GCs, UV, the printout is not the raw material, no matter what your SOP says. Because I've been to places where it says, in our facility, we consider the printout to be the raw data. That's fine for you, that's not fine for the authorities. The raw data is where the first capture point. Are you all familiar with the term metadata? Metadata is a really important issue. Some people are always confused by this. If you go home and your wife is on the telephone, you can hear the discussion from her side of it, or his side of it, your spouse is on the phone. And you know the conversation is going on, and you can hear one side of the conversation. You have no idea who they're speaking to. A month later, when you get your phone bill, you'll get a list of the date, who was called, the time of the call, and the duration of the call. That is the metadata giving context to the one-sided conversation you heard a month ago. So the conversation itself is the data. The metadata gives you the background to it. Metadata without the data is useless. Data without the metadata is useless. So you need to make sure that you keep both. So when you have a chromatogram, you can see the printout, but the metadata is all the who did the assay, what time they did the assay, what other assays were done. That's all the metadata, and that's what needs to be seen in the audit trail. So the data describes the structure, the interrelationships, and other characteristics. It's an integral part of the original record, and without the metadata, the data has no meaning. You need to make sure of the accuracy, completeness, and content of the meaning of the data and the metadata throughout the data lifecycle. So if Regis is making an API, and you do, and your typical expiration date is what, 3 years? Let's say 3 years. Then you need to keep the data for how long? Not 3 years. Because your API is going into somebody else's tablets, and they have a 4 year expiration date, and the GMP says you keep data for the expiration date plus 1 year or 2 years in Europe, so that your customer has 4 years plus, say, one, that's five, plus your three is eight, and then your lawyers will say keep it forever. But you have to think about the usage and the data retention time, okay? You need to worry about destruction of the data, and you need to consider the criticality and applicable legislative retention requirements. Archiving data should be in place for long-term retention of relevant data in compliance with legislation. I became the QA manager of a company, and I was looking at all our data. We had nice computers, which at that time had 3.5-inch floppy disks. I inherited some 11-inch disks, the original Wang disks. Couldn't read them. Had no way of knowing what the data said. That's one of the problems we have today. CD-ROMs as a data media storage is old hat. It's going out the way. You keep your data on a cloud. Where's the cloud? Anyone know where the cloud is? Who controls the cloud? How do you know what's happening to your data? All these things come up. Cloud computing. You like the clouds? It took me a long time to find a picture of clouds. All right. Here's a big issue, because everybody's going to the cloud, both for downloading software and for keeping your data. We have software providers who have SaaS, ISaaS, software as a service, infrastructure as a service. If you want to buy Microsoft Word today, you probably can't buy it as a disk. You can only rent it for them and have to pay a fee every year. They're keeping it as a service. You rent the service. Same with Adobe. When you're trying to print out documents, you can't buy the disk anymore. I still use version 9 because it's on the disk that I've got. Otherwise, if I went to today's version 13, every year I've got to pay $130. To me, that's insane, but that's how they make money. So where you use a cloud or virtual services, you have to pay attention to understand what is being provided, who owns it, how you retrieve it, how it's retained, and its security. The physical location where the data is held, including the impact of any laws applicable to that geographic location, should be considered. Has anybody heard of the Svalbard Islands in northern Arctic Ocean, Svalbard? It's a little set of islands owned by Norway. And it is year-round average temperature, 30 degrees. It is cold. And these server farms, which have all these computerization, get very, very hot. So they are looking for places where they can cool it down. Ah, Svalbard. And we now have several data farms up in Svalbard. Who owns that data? Well, the company you hire from. But what is the legislative rules for that data? Norway? Well, that depends on which part of Svalbard you are, because half of Svalbard is Russian. So you're going to go with the laws of Russia to keep your data? And data hacking? I mean, we've heard that recently. Or is it going to be in the Norway? But have you even thought about this? Responsibility of the contract giver or acceptor, and remember the cloud is a contract acceptor. You're going to tell them, store my data, has to be defined in a technical agreement. And if you want to go audit it, anybody want to go to Svalbard? It's difficult to get to, by the way. You need to have timely access to the data, including the metadata and audit trails. And you need to have kept by the data owner and the national competent authorities on request. You should be able to go there with reasonable advance notice. Hey, I want to come and audit your facilities for GMP compliance, because this is part of GMP, and I want to come next November. Oh, I can't come in November. Why not? Well, there's no plane and no boat. Oh. So you've got to think about those sort of things. Contracts with providers define the responsibilities for archiving, continued readability of the data throughout the retention period, and appropriate arrangements exist for the restoration of the software or the season as per its original interactive validated state. Many people rent software these days. I just mentioned Word. They say the advantage of renting software is we are constantly updating it, so you never have an old version. And then you say, well, what about constantly validating your updates? And you get silence. Because if you're buying a validated software, great, you can use it. But if they update it and don't even tell you it's automatic, we do it every day, every night. And then they don't tell you it's validated, now you get into trouble when FDA shows up. So this is a big issue. And business continuity arrangements should include in the contract and tested. Supposing your cloud provider in Svalbard goes out of business, or there is an earthquake, because that is an earthquake zone, and the whole of the island goes. Now what do you do? Do you have backup plans? So this data integrity business, especially as more and more people are going to the cloud, becomes more and more difficult.